My mom is going to try to make the bed. So, Ben, if you can...
Okay.
If you can take the broadcast for a while. I think I have to let my mom do this.
Okay.
Herbie?
We'll let Enrique go and make his bed. Meanwhile, we're on board of Cameo as he runs up to the Mulsanne. On board with Johan van Doren there, 27th overall for Jura Racing, 10th in the P1 category. We saw them have that massive off at the Porsche curves earlier on, where they lost their rear wing, and now they've gone off into Indy. Oh, that hasn't gone well. That is an off and a half. It cost them even more time, may have done some damage to the front right suspension as well. Really not a race to remember so far for them. They're of course running the Zytec 06S petrol LMP1, I believe. And they're the only team running it along with Simtek Jota. The rest are running either the Audi R10 or the Peugeot 908. And then we had Rush Motorsports with the Epsilon Escudiae. Dewey Tapper there then, second in the P2 class, 8th overall for Drake Racing. Just taken over from James Johnson. And now his mentality will be trying to catch up with the racing guys who so far put in a flawless performance for trying to take the P1 lead, P2 lead in. Jacob Project there for Team RGPL Czech. They're third in the P2 class, quite a way behind the Dragony racing cars. Nevertheless, they're still in with a shout should anything bad happen to the front two P2 cars. Wesley St. George there for Velocity Racing Car 405. Ninth for the P1 class and 18th overall. We saw them involved in quite a few accidents earlier on. Around the 4 hour mark. Now we do have a car in the pits, so we have three cars in the pits. We have Rush Motorsport. There we go, Ben Russell. They've lost their nose again, that's not good. We also have the leader, 3Y Motorsports, Fabio Enders, in the pits. We have. Oh, look at that! Oh, this is interesting. I wonder if Ben Russell's is in Fabio Enders' pit. They must have the same pit box. That's going to cost the leader loads. In the background, we see Team RGPL HDI. That's the P1 one of Jan Prusa. And we've also got Special 5 with Adam Kovacs behind. Both in the pits. This seems to be a little issue here in the pits. Oh, Kovacs just gets around Enders. And we've got a driver change behind. Copitho is now driving the Team RGPL. We'll leave them in the pits as we switch over to Alexis Korat there, overtaking some traffic. No one to run a quiet race for 5-1 Racing. Fourth in the P1 category and fourth overall, running that Audi R10. He's desperately trying to catch up to Pedro Gomez in the Project XTR, but he's got a 38 second gap to make up, and that is a tall order. And guess how much that costs 3Y Motorsports, because they've only just been able to get into the pit spot and they've lost a position to Lustanium SR, who now take the lead. We thought they'd keep that lead for a long time, and this mix up has cost them massively. Let's switch over to your new leader now, Nuno Pinto from the Stadium SR. This is the point where he needs to floor it and try and bridge the gap over to 3Y Motorsports as they have that pit trouble. coming through the PlayStation chicane. Now onto the second mile stand. Nice and tidy there in the Peugeot. And from the rear view mirror, look how fast it's going. Catching up on traffic there into the second chicane. Remember the faster cars, the prototype cars, have to give way in effect to the GT cars, and whilst the GT cars hold their line. So I just had a message from Antti Hietalan, one of the drivers at Lusitania SR, and he said to me, we had an escape and rejoin due to a lot of damage on the car, our position on the live timing is not representative, and they will have a penalty added post-race for escaping and rejoining. So technically they shouldn't be in the lead, but they currently are, but they won't be. That makes no sense. In other words, they will get a lap penalty after the race for escaping and rejoining, which would in theory put them behind the three-wide motorsports car. So with that in mind, unfortunately Pinto is not our new leader in effect. Pedro Gomez here for Project XTR, fourth overall and fourth in P1. Don't want the cars to run quite a quiet opening to the air race. Which is obviously a good thing. You don't want to get caught up in trouble. You want that quiet race just to break into your rhythm in effect, and to get the strategy working. But nevertheless, quite a quiet start, and that'll play to their strengths, and hopefully they can try and bridge the gap up to 5-1 Racing, who are in third. Live timing has just gone crazy. Wait to get that back. We have a Club AV car, and the GTE is in the pits. We're on board now with the number 605 SRW car with Dimitri Giannopoulos at the wheel. We saw them lose a wheel earlier on at Tête Rouge. But they're 6th in GT and 22nd overall. Joe Omerland there, we saw him get into some serious trouble at the Porsche Kurs, where he hit the wall about three times. He is unfortunately trundling around 8th in P2 and 26th overall. Not very good. Well, this is the point where I bid you farewell, guys, and Enrico will hopefully be back in a few minutes. We'll probably take a little break then for a bit until he comes back. And I've had a great fun commentating for this bit, and also I hope Drake could do well. That'll be a bias to me, hope the race goes well. And yeah, keep on watching, guys, and enjoy the rest of this 24-hour race. Goodbye.
Sorry about that. Back. Just had to do a quick pit stop to eat and let my mum make the bed. Yeah, my mum still doesn't make my bed. Sorry. We are following Javier Ugalde. He's currently P5 on LAP2s and he is P... how much? P12 on overall. He's using a Porsche. Pretty much all LAP2 cars are Porsches. And I lost my... I lost something. I can't remember what. Traffic jam behind Lenny Hall.
Traffic jam?
Yeah. mas vê, e quer? Olha o que quer. Não, espera. Vê. Faz isso tudo pelos que estão em cima, os primeiros. O i7, ou o i5. As memórias da DR3. O 780Ti, ou 780 normal. E pode ser. O dos Correios dão menos. O dos Correios dão 1 TB ou 2 e está nada de mal.
Os Correios tens.
Yeah, tá. Mas vai. Fazer um computador com essas coisas, para FSGs. Oh, pôs. Já vês quanto é que. Lá no coisa.
Sim, tu queres um i7, não pode ser um i5?
Pode, mas um i7 é o que os gajos aqui que têm mais. And while Van Doren almost crashing, on Molson corner, could see him lock up completely on the entrance for the corner. And I'm back, yeah, I'm still alive. It's just checking a couple of things on the background. But I'm back. Oh, and again, Hoffenheim on Indianapolis is going, missing the brakes. Oh, almost crashing into Fabio. Does he got any problem with the brakes? That's the first question that you can make it. Quaret coming. If I'm not wrong, he's not fighting with Juan Van Doren. No, he's not. He's actually fighting with Fabio Enders. The leader of this race is Nuno Pinto. He's got one more lap of Michael Kopitu. Well, 2 minutes and something. It's almost a lap. So the Portuguese driver from the Portuguese team is leading the race after a complete domination from 3-wide Motorsport LMP1 team. Oh, Turazzi going weird on four chicanes. Going to get dark now in about 40 minutes thereabouts, and night will settle in and you're probably gonna see more mistakes being committed at this time of the race. If you don't hear me talk, it's because I'm doing stuff on the background, so don't think I died. I just went to do something in the background. Potsus. Thank you. So yeah, we are back. Nuno Pinto, I said Nuno Pinto was leading, is not. Is being applied penalties for pressing ESC after the race has ended. So you're looking for minus 2 laps thereabouts for Nuno Pinto. So the leader is, if I'm not wrong, which I usually am, Michael Kupik. And this is the fight for second position. Just grab the fight as it happens. So Pedro Gomes defending from Fabio Enders for second position overall. And I think I have Kyle. Kyle, are you there?
Are you there?
Hello.
Hello. How are you today?
How are you today?
I'm good, thanks, how are you?
Always good. You've been watching the race, I think.
Yeah, I've been watching it a little bit. I've also been doing other things with my flight simulator, but I've only been watching it for about the last 10 minutes. Sadly, I've missed a few hours.
Yeah. You've been watching for 10 minutes. 10 minutes I've been away doing stuff on the background and the cameras have been stopped. But anyway, you said that you've been a ex-sim racer?
That's correct, yeah. I haven't been racing much off actor, but things like GT5 I used to race on, and also a bit of Formula 1 2013 as well.
Yeah, exactly. As Pedro Gomes does a spin and crashes the car. You said too that you've been doing things on Flight Simulator?
Yeah, that's correct, yes. I'm a bit of a flight simulator.
Yeah, well, we are both then.
That's good.
Yeah, that's good. Anyway. Moving on, we won't get bogged down on Flight Simulator, otherwise we're going to start talking and probably won't end by the end of the race. Because flying is one of the things that I prefer to do, apart from racing and stuff. So, let's see what's happening. Oh, the Porsche there on the pit entrance. So you're watching the race via what? Simrace TV?
At the moment, yes. I'm hoping to get a Twitch link if possible.
Traffic jam there. Oh, Turazi. Well, this guy's crashed when I'm not looking at. Almost a crash in the background. You saw that, as well as I did. That's why I said traffic jam. Now, Turazi, what happened here? Schinbach is coming. He breaks. Oh, he loses the back end. Okay. Usual kind of crash for a GT driver to have. Oh. Almost losing the back end again. Ryan Hall passing by, Kokoza passing by. Oh, Victor changed drivers for Cadillac. Cadillac now entered the car after 5 hours of racing. He's in the car. It's going to be dark in about, if the Ech Factor hours are correct, at 8:30 will be full darkness. Are with Porsche's time, obviously, so it's 7:25. In about 1 hour, full darkness will fall on Le Mans, at least on the game. Marius Bert is looking for something. Pedro Gomes spun again on the Porsches. Oh, we braked. And touch the green, the grass and the green, yeah, the green pad, and spun. That's bad. Marius Bert coming. Someone is asking for an onboard lap of Marius Bert. Onboard lap with Marius Bert. I'm gonna shut up at least. One full lap, so I'm all sent straight. Michelin chicane. There you go. So there you go, on board lap with Marius Bert. Flat out, pretty much all the way, and Marius doing a great lap, and somebody's messing about with don't move the mouse on Simrace TV. So there you go. He's not the leader of the race, I think it's 51 Racing with the Audi, but we'll have to still confirm this information with Ugo. So, moving on. I'm gonna try to put on Anthony De Mera and see one lap of him on board, just to you guys that watched Marius go around to see the difference. So, where is De Mera? Oh, here he is. Here he is. So, Mulsanne corner. And away we go. LMP2 lap of Le Mans. Starting from Mulsanne corner, just now. Oh well, I knew that he would come to the pits, he's always like this. So GT leader then. Oof, whoa, James crashing into Mulsanne corner. So if you're watching the race lifetiming and you're thinking, oh well, that's a mess on the very top of the qualification, that's because they are all virtual leaders. The penalties about ESC and escaping and quitting and coming back to the race will be, and penalties obviously, will be applied on the end of the race. So they are virtual leaders, and then they are the real leaders we don't know yet, just on the end of the race basically. So this is the leader of GTs. Jean-Charles René. Semi-French, semi-British. I'm gonna go inboard with him in a moment. Just needs to complete four chicanes and the Mulsanne block. Hopefully he will do that. I won't go to the pits like the LMP2 leader. Nope. There we go. Donut view, as always. Oh crap. There you go. Full lap on a GT car. leader of the GD guards. And I'll talk to you soon when they finish their lap, Edley. Back, and with Jean and Charles René being pressured by Osvaldo Cocosa, and Osvaldo Cocosa being Cocosa, gotta try to take the first position from the other Porsche. On board with Osvaldo, and this is a fight that's gonna last for, I don't know, 10 minutes. So, you guys are gonna go on board with Osvaldo Cocosa until he passes by Charles, which will happen one way or the other, because Charles, I think, has the tires are dying, or already done, already died, sorry. So. Great move from Osvaldo Cocosa, was commentating in Portuguese with Mike off. Mistake there from Cocosa, and then Charles making an even bigger mistake in Indianapolis, losing the first position on Arnage and Hammer. Passing by. F1 driver passing by, by the way. Cocosa wide, drifting wide on the first Porsche corner. And Osvaldo retrieving the first position and again going sideways. Osvaldo Cocosa. So I think Osvaldo has completely died, killed the tires. Oh, both of them going wide. Marco Kozovic passing by. F1 driver driving for Lusitania MSR, which I think, if I'm not wrong, is going to pass the Dart car to Ricardo Ferreira. So we're going to see Ricardo Ferreira driving a LMP1 car, and if you want to laugh with crashes, that's the moment you want to watch the Peugeot 908 from Lusitania. Osvaldo meanwhile going deep onto that left tender. Oh, this fight is one to watch then. This is a fight for the first position on GTs. Osvaldo Cocosa retrieving the position from Charles on the Arnage corner. This is Tetra Rouge. Ooh, Charles going deep to Tetra Rouge. Run down to into PlayStation chicane and a ghost passing by, that name Pedro Gomes from Projectia. Cocosa locking up the tire, the brakes. Oh, Charles almost going wide. And we have Ognobro with me.
Hello again.
Hello. You could have talked.
I know. So here we are, 5 hours have passed. How is the racing, Eric?
Good.
We just saw a pretty good fight between the leads on the LMGT class, between Spirit and Endurance Gentlelady and RFTT. It seems that Osvaldo is slowly running away from the Spirit Endurance Porsche.
Yeah, he is quicker.
Yeah, you were saying that their tires are pretty much dead. So that means they should be pitting very soon. I believe that Virgin de Cosne, which is helping out on the Marshall side tonight, today, I believe she is going to enter the car in the next stop, or I believe. So I think they should be pitting very soon, both of the cars.
Yeah, and that's not new. See the car sliding a lot on the right hander or before Indianapolis. I don't know. What's that situation with the leaders? I mean.
Basically, to clear this up, we have decided that the penalties regarding disconnects and ESCs or CTDs are going to be applied only after the race. That means that live penalties will be applied only for crashes, race incidents, and that's all. All the other penalties are going to be applied and reviewed after the race. So we can look at the standings as of now. And those are the virtual leaders. For example, we know that Lusitan MS are going to have two penalties regarding disconnects, but there are more teams in that situation. So only after the race we will review all stuff and apply the necessary penalties.
Three cars into Mulsa and Kona. Great. Hopefully not. They all passed, but...
Oh, there was three cars... This is Kopitko and Marius Bert.
Yeah.
I believe that Kopitko is on P3, that's correct. The leaders are Lusitan MSR, followed by 3Wide Motorsport, and P3 is Team RGPL. Fourth position for 51 Racing. Very clean race for this team today. They did not make the best of qualifyings on Wednesday, but here they are, battling for at least a podium. They are on the same lap of the position number 2, which belongs to 3Wide. So, pretty good race for 51 Racing today. Position 5 is for Project XTR. Pedro Gomes is at the wheel at the moment.
Also, having an easy race, by the way.
Also on the same lap. P6 for Special 5. Then on P7 we have the fantastic team of E-Racing Propulsion. They are currently on P7 overall and of course leading the LMP2 class. Then on position 8.
It's fantastic.
We have Simtek Jota.
Hey! Why is that team fantastic and all the others is not?
Because they are very good. If you look at the qualifying on Wednesday, they demolished basically the LMP2 class on qualifying. And they are proving here today in the race that they are the team to beat. And also they are in front of some LMP1s, so props to the guys. Like I was saying, Simtek Jota is on P8, P9 for Ger Racing, also another LMP1. Then we have the LMP2 guys, on 10th place overall and 2nd on the LMP2 class. We have Team RGP Alkzek, 11th place for Drag Racing. Pretty good race for this team. 12th place for FVR team. 13 for Cooper Racing. 14 Killer Motorsport. On 15 we have another LMP1, this time from Rush Motorsports. an eventful race for Daryl Russell. On P16 overall and the 7th on the LMP2s, we have Club AV. 17 overall, Velocity Racing, the last of the LMP1s. Then on the LMGT class, the leaders, RFDT Racing on P18 overall, P19 Spirit Endurance Gentlady, P20th, 3 Wide Motorsport, 21st for Jamaica Boys, 22nd for Rush Motorsport GT, 23rd for SRW, 24th for Pro Race Simulation, 25th Team RGPL, 26th All Brothers Racing, 27th Club AV, 28th IR Racing, and 29th Leader Racing Team. Of course, that racing and the Leader Racing Team. Those lap times in the table.
X-Men crashing in there. No. There you go. What happened? Marius Bert is coming. I think it was Marius. No. But oh yeah, it was. Big crash there. Marius won't be very good on the picture, that one. Oh, you shouldn't do that. What is there? Not being very friendly to the Ferrari of Prosim Racing. Why do all GT cars go wide on Mulsanne Corner? I don't know. No one understood. James Wilson from Jamaica Boys. Daniel Faber, Tried Models by GT. Mr. Sean Alchinet. On Michelin Chicane. Osvaldo Cocausa, leader of GTs. And coming to the end of. Mulsanne straight, oof, going a bit to the left. Mulsanne corner, locking up, woo, that's a big lock up for Osvaldo Cocausa. Right, front right wheel won't be round for many long. Where is it later? There it is. The leader of LMP2 on board. Drive through for 3 Wide Motorsport LMP1 because of that touch on the Ferrari. still on board with the LMP2 leader. The Mayor still doing what he was built to do, go fast with the LMP2 car. These guys are one of the targets, especially for the LMP2 cars. They are at the moment at P7 overall. They are in front of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4. 4 LMP1 cars, so it is pretty good race for these guys. Big opposite lock there for the Nevada, flashing their lights for the Porsche. Porsche gains, couple of drivers on the pits, Galde, St. George, all LMP2 cars, and one lap down for the leader of LMP2s. Gilles Sarrazin, we didn't talk about much about F1 racing, but they're still in it. So they are racing at home, so don't despise them. Ballenhama with no headlights turned on, that could be a problem. Kopico with lights on. Shane Burke or Adam Williams. Pedro Gomes for the XCR car. I'm Marius Wert. absolute nightmare nowadays. sorry about that. 8 o'clock, 8:05 p.m. 8:05 p.m. on Portugal, and full night, full darkness on Le Mans. From now on is a night race, so if you don't see the cars, don't worry, we don't as well. But I was gonna say that before I had to push Ilario into the channel, that night time is always better, because obviously the because of the amount of effects that the air factor has for the night. This is the jump-ish of Le Mans. End of Mall Saint Street. Now the night factor comes into play as well. All laps were corrected in live timing, so if you were trying to know what laps were in, you know, you can go and see. All laps are corrected and ready to go. Talking on which I have to. So, leader of the race. This light timing worked. Marko Kozovic, and this is always virtual leaders. Yeah. Mikael Kopiko is P2, Maris Bert is P3, P4 is Gilles Sarrazin, and P5 is Pedro Gomes. This is the top 5 at 8:07 p.m. in Portugal. So, Five hours and a half of racing, and with Ilario here, I'm gonna try and get some rest into my eyes, and I'm gonna see you back in a short time. I'm not sure if Ilario will commentate. I'm pretty sure he won't, but anyway, there you go.
Yeah, I'll try my best.
There you go. So that will try to commentate a bit. I'm gonna try to ask to Ugu to help if he can. I'm pretty sure he won't, because he's not watching on our viewer. Ilario, good luck.
Thank you, mate. Don't fall asleep.
I won't. 10, I'm here.
Okay, have a good rest. Okay, so I'm back. I've been configuring some things, so I'm sorry for that. So night time is here, and this is where it all gets tricky and difficult. It's been a few hours now since the beginning of the race, so many drivers are, although they're most of the teams have changed drivers. The drivers must be getting somewhat tired, as well as the team, and everyone's been awake for a while and trying to focus. And so, this is where it all starts to get difficult. So far, from what I've seen, it's been a very interesting race. I've been following it for about an hour, and it's been interesting. Not many battles in on the track, but in the live timing, it's really interesting, especially if you actually heard Enrique say about the fact that some teams will have penalties applied later. By the end of the race, leaving all the results available now, are not final, so many things can actually change. So just have to continue to watch and see the outcome by by tomorrow. So provisional results state that Lusitanium SR team with Marco Koskovic on the wheel is actually the leader, but we know that's not true because they have some penalties applied for pressing ESC throughout the these few hours. So possibly, and I have to check this first, but possibly team RPGPL will be the leaders, but still have to confirm that with Hugo. So I just got a tip. Just got a tip about this fight happening on track. So that's Osvaldo Cocosa against trying to run away from the driver behind, which is let me check. Virginie Dicosne. I don't know if that's the right way to say it, but those two drivers are actually fighting for position on track. Let's stay with them for a while. Oh my god, this is actually epic. just made this really bad rookie mistake, because Hugo just corrected me. Actually, Osvaldo is trying to evade Virgin, which is not a man driver, but a female driver. I just told that we're going to follow these two guys, but actually it's a man and a woman, so let's follow these drivers. That's probably more correct. Let's see the outcome of this this battle so far. So Osvaldo seems to be pulling away. Virgin is not being as fast as Osvaldo, so the gap is getting bigger, stretching. It's not stretching like losing sight, but actually Osvaldo is maintaining a very good distance and actually trying to get away from Virgin as fast as he can. Yeah. So here on board our only female driver. Just when we got a hint from Ugo saying that Cooper Racing just got a drive-through penalty for hitting another car from behind. I don't know if they served the penalty already, but that's some information from for figure guys. So here you go, we just saw the driver Javier Ugald from Cooper Racing doing doing his drive-through penalty. Just have to try his best to try and clean and get the time back that he lost. Oh god, he just hit the wall. He lost the back end there and just went right to the sidewall. Probably got some damage on the front right of his car. I think actually the front panel actually fell. Let's see if we can actually prove this. Yeah, no front end. I just skipped the spot track. Yeah, probably having some issues with the grip, since he doesn't have all the front part of his car. You have to crawl back to pits and try to fix his front end. Really unfortunately, actually, just went into the into the track from doing his drive-through penalty, and is going to end up in the pits again. Really misfortune. So we're now, and he's going, went off again on the braking part, on braking. We're just following Javier Ugalde. That after doing a drive through penalty, just lost the back end and hit the wall. So it has a lot of damage to the front of his car. And he's just crawling his way back to pits to try and fix it. There he goes. Breaking hard to. He's in the pits. Okay, well, front end is actually being replaced. It's been replaced already. That will take some time to get everything ready so it can actually go out. So, plenty of time lost again from for this driver. So let's check what else is going on track. Okay, so we see Javier's actually out. So to make the all the time lost. So we just saw Daryl Russell trying to get into the pits, just a bit too eager to do his pitting, so he actually almost crashed as he went into the pit. So I think probably from what I've seen here in Lifetime, he'll probably lose a position to the driver behind him, which is Lifetime is gone. Just wait a second. Yeah, to I think so. To Dominic Sawicki. Was it Rafael Camille? No. I think it was to Dominic Sawicki. Okay, and Rush Motorsport just did driver swap there. So Darrell went off, and Ben Russell is at the wheel. Okay, so we're on board Rafael De Matteo. De Matteo is at, yeah, that's it. It's just 6 seconds away from the driver in front of him, Camilo, I think so. Sorry, I said Rafael De Matteo. No, it's actually Ricardo De Matteo. And he's trying to catch up with Rafael Camilo. And he's maintaining some pressure on Rafael, so the gap is actually maintaining or getting shorter, but just. So here we go. We're on board the Gala. Trying to catch Rafael Camille. Just a few minutes back, it actually looked like he was actually getting closer. Now I'm not so sure. Although the live timing says yeah, he's actually getting closer. Just about closer, but still getting closer. Just saw a driver off there. As you can see, Rafael is actually on site now. So Ricardo's getting really, really closer now. And yeah. Live timing confirms it. Is actually 3 seconds away, so it's getting closer. Just have to maintain here, be patient, and we'll eventually see an on-track overtake. So it's good. So here with Ricardo Di Matteo, we see Sarazans. He's the current fourth place man, provisionally, at least. And actually, Ricardo can use this. He can actually attack now. So that when Sarazans tries to overtake Rafael, he can actually get a bit closer. Just depends on where Sarazans will overtake Rafael. saw the Porsche going out there, Santos. Just run a bit too wide. And actually, all these drivers are going to start hitting some traffic now, so it's gonna be interesting. So here we are, trying we're on the other end of the spectrum now. So we see with Rafael Camilo, you see Ricardo in the background, just trying to gain some ground there, but it's actually not happening in this last lap, because although now he actually looks closer, but the live timing says that Rafael Camilo is maintaining a 3-second gap, so there's not much gain there. So. Rafael being lapped there by a P1 car. Just saw while he was overtaking Ricardo on the background, still trying to gain some ground. Here we go. Well, I can actually see that the gap actually looks the same, so it's not getting bigger or shorter. So these drivers are somewhat at the similar pace, so this could be interesting to follow. Yeah, actually, Live Timing says that Rafael Camilo did 3:37.0 this last lap, and Ricardo Di Matteo did 3:37.6, so just six tenths away. So that's not it's not very much in a long track like this. And yeah. So far we have 28 teams still racing. It's been almost 7 hours since the beginning of the race, so 6 hours and 50. We still have 28 teams on board with us, still racing, which is something that does not cease to amaze me, because We have 20. We had in the beginning, I think, 30-ish cars with at least 3 drivers each. So that makes around 90 something people racing on this event, which is, my God, really amazing. You have to mobilize almost 100 people to be at the same place at the same time, and everyone has their own agenda, their own personal life, their own whatever, and they actually managed to get themselves, I don't know, arranged in a way that they all can participate in an event like this, which is something that really, really amazes me, because although this is called like sim racing, this is still a game, and we actually lose a lot of time on this, and it's, I don't know, I'm almost speechless to see the amount of dedication and how many people actually enjoy doing this this activity that we do. So we just saw there Rafael and Ricardo, so the gap actually looked exactly the same. So what I thought would be on track fight is actually another time fight. So, oof, Rafael getting really close there to the wall. Great shot there from Rafael's car. Just seeing the cars in the background with all the lights on, it's actually really nice. So Rafael will be getting some traffic now. Be hitting some traffic, so probably be a bit slower there. Good chance for Ricardo to approach. So we're now seeing a 2.9 gap from Rafael over Ricardo, which means that Ricardo gained a bit there and it's getting closer. It's not exactly visible here at the some of the fastest parts of the track, as the cars actually tend to the gap tends to stretch visually, so it's a bit hard to see it, but it's actually getting cars are getting a bit closer. So here we go, this is what we were talking about earlier. So Rafael is actually hitting traffic already. Just saw he had to do some